No, if you go down the local pub, they're playing Mr. Tambourine Man, the times are changing. But this is going to be something rather different and rather unusual, as you've probably gathered. We don't really know what's going to happen, so let's make a start anyway. I'm Chris Gregory, and I'm the author of this book, which is called Determined to Stand. And a bit later on, I'm going to do a reading from the book and explain why it's called Determined to Stand, amongst other things. But I'll start with something a little bit experimental and a little bit different. Bob Dylan is, of course, a poet, and he has actually written a lot of actual poems. And the poem I'm going to perform for you tonight is called Poem to Joni, and it originally appeared on an album called Joan Baez in Concert Volume 2. I'm sure you know Bob and Joan were rather romantically involved at the time. So, I hope you like this. This is quite obscure. It doesn't even appear in any of the lyric books. So, here we go. This is Poem to Joni. Now, I've got a little few technical things to do. So, occasionally you'll see me run back there and push a button. If anything goes wrong, don't panic. Okay? Okay. Poem to Joni. In my youngest years, I used to kneel by my aunt's house on a railroad field and yank the grass out of the ground and rip savagely at its roots and pass the hours counting strands and stains of green grew on my hands as I waited till I heard the sound of the iron ore cars rolling down. The tracks at home and I'd bite my lip and hold my grip as the whistle whined, crouching low as the engine growled. I'd shyly wave to the throttle man and count the cars as they roll past. Thank you, Robert. Listen. When the echo faded in the day, and I understood the train was gone, it's then that my eyes turned back to my hands with stains of green that line my palms like blood that tells I've taken and not given in return. But glancing back to the empty patch where the ground was turned upside down and the roots lay dead beneath the tree, I'd say, how can this bother me? Or, I'm sure the grass don't give a damn. Anyway, it'll grow again and lots of patch of grass anyhow. And I'd wipe my hand to wash the stain and fling a rock across the track with the echo of the railroad train hanging heavy like a thundercloud in the dawn of tomorrow's rain. And I ask myself to be my friend and I walk my road like a frightened fox and I sung my song like a demon child with a kick and a curse from inside my mother's womb. In later years, although still young, my head swung heavy with winding curves, and a mixed up path revolved and spun within the boundaries of my youth, till at last my back so far away from the world's wolves and friendless games, that I didn't have a word to say to anyone who'd meet my eyes. And I locked myself and lost the key, and let the symbols take their shape and form a foe for me to fight, to lash my tongue and rebel against and spit at strong with vomit words. But I learned to choose my idols well, to be my voice and tell my tale, and help me fight my phantom roar. My first idol was Hank Williams. They sang about the railroad lines, the iron cars and the rattling wheels. Left no doubt that they were real. And my first symbol was the word beautiful. For the railroad lines were not beautiful. They were smoky black and gutter coloured and filled with stink and soot and dust. And I judged beauty with these rules and accepted only if it was ugly and if I could touch it with my hand. For it's only then I'd understand and say, yeah, this is real. And I walked my road and sung my song like a saddened clown in a circus in my own world. In later times, my idols fell, for I learned that they were only men and had reasons for their deeds, for which weren't mine not at all, and no more on them could I depend. But what I learned from each forgotten god was that the battlefield was mine alone, and only I could cast me stone, and the symbols which by now had grown out of shape and strong in sight were seen by me in the sharper light, and the symbol beauty still struck my guts, but now in the more shameful sound. And I rebelled twice as hard and 10 times as proud. And I walked my road and sang my song like an arch criminal who'd done no wrong and committed no crime, but was screaming through the bars of somebody else's prison. Later, yet in New York town, on my own terms, I said with age, the only beauties in the cracks and curves, clothed in robes of dust and grime. And I searched for it in every hole, and jumped head on to meet its breast, and whispered tunes into its ear, and kissed its mouth, and held its waist, and in its body swung around, and on its belly passed out cold. And like a blind lover bold in flight, I shouted from inside my wounds, the voice to speak for me and mine is a hard, filthy, gutter sound, for it's only this that I can touch, and the only beauty I can feel. And I dove back in by my own choice to feed my skin hungry holes and rejected every other voice. And I walked my road and sung my song like a lonesome king standing in the fury of the Queen's garden, staring into a shallow grave. Time travelled and faces passed, and many times thoughts to me were taught by names and hands too many to count that touched my path and soon were gone. But some stayed on to remain as friends. And though each is first and none is best, it is at this time I speak for one who proved to me that boys still grow. A girl I met on common ground, who like me, strummed lonesome tunes. With a lovely voice, so I first heard, a thing of beauty, people said. Wondrous sounds, writers wrote. I hate that kind of sound, said I. The only beauty locally, man. The cracking, shaking, breaking sounds are the only beauty I understand. So between our tongues there was a bar, and though we talked of the world's fears, and at the same jokes loudly laughed, and held our eyes at the same aim, when I saw she was set to sing, a fence of deafness with a bullet's speed sprang up like a protecting glass outside the lining of my ears. I talked loud inside my head as a double shield against the sounds. Ain't no voice but an ugly voice. The rest, I don't give a damn. For I can't feel it with my hands, then don't wish me to understand. But I'll wait until the song is done, because there's something about you, but I don't know what. And I walked my road, and I sung my song, like a scared poet walking on the shore, picking driftwood with my shadow, afraid of the sea. Just tell me. In a cruising car, I heard her tell about the child and hours she spent. It's a little girl in an Arab land. She told me of the dogs she saw slaughtered wholly on the street. And I learned of how people had laughed as they beat the gentle dogs to death. Through a child's eyes, we tried and failed to hide one dog inside her house. And I turned my head without a word and coldly stared out to the road. And with the wind hitting half my face, my memory creeped as the highway rolled back, if not looked for a flash, to the empty patch of grass that died about the same time a dog was hit. And that guilty feeling sprang again, not over the roots I pulled, but over she who saw the dogs get killed. And I said softly underneath my breath, you ought to listen to her voice, maybe something's in the sand. Ah, but what does she care anyway? Kill them thoughts, yes, they ain't no good, only uglies understood. And I stuck my head out in the wind, Let a breeze blow the words out of my breath as a truck roared by and almost blew it off the road. And at the time, I had no song to sing. In Woodstock, in a painter's house, with friends scattered round the room, and she talking from a chair, and me cross-legged on the rug, I lit a cigarette and laughed, and gulped to light red wine and lost every shaking vein that dwelled within the rooms of my dancing heart. And the room it whirled and twirled and sailed without one fence standing guard. When all at once, the silent air split open from her sounding voice without no warning from her lips. And by instinct, my blood reversed and I shook and started reaching for the wall that was supposed to fall. And my resting nerves were restless now, and this time they wouldn't jump. Let her voice ring out, they cried. But too tired to stop her singing, it shattered all the rules I had and left me puzzled without no choice except to listen to her voice. When I leaned on my elbows there, that literally held my body up, I felt my face freeze to the bone, and my mouth on ice or solid stone. Couldn't have moved and called upon, and time like velvet floated by, until with hunger pains it cried, "Don't stop singing, sing again." And like others who've taught me well, not about themselves but me, she laughed out loud, as if to know that the bars between us busted down. And I laughed almost an insane laugh, and aimed it at the ceiling walls. When I realised the command I called, and my elbows folded under me, and my head lay back upon the floor, and my shaking arms went floating free. But I memorised the words to write for another time in tomorrow's dawn, and held close on challenged dreams as I passed out somewhere in the noise. I did not begin to touch till I finally felt what wasn't there. Oh, how feebly foolish, small and sad, for me to think that beauty was only ugliness and blood. When really, it's just a magic wand that waves and teases at my mind and knows that only it can feel, and knows that I ain't got a chance, and fools me into thinking things like it's my hands that understand. Ha ha, how it must laugh at cripple ones like me who try to pick apart the sounds of streams and pluck apart the rage of waves. Ah, but you won't fool me anymore, for the breeze I heard in a young girl's breath proved true as sex and womanhood, and deep as the lowest depths of death, and as strong as the weakest winds that blow, and as long as fate and fatherhood, and like gypsy drums, and Chinese gongs, and cathedral bells, and tones and chimes, just now hymns of mystery, and mysteries all too involved, that can't be understood or solved by hands and feet and fingertips. And it shouldn't be called by the shameful name, by those who look for answers plain, and every book set themselves. Go ahead, lightning, laugh at me, flash your teeth, slap your knee. It's your joke, I agree. I'm even pointing at myself. But it's a shame, it's taking so much time. So once more, it's winter again. And that means I'll wait till spring to ramble back to where I kneeled when I first heard the ore train sing. He pulled the ground up by its roots. But this time, I won't use my strength to pass the time yanking grass while I'm waiting for the train to sound. No, next time, it'll be a different day. For the train might be there when they come, and I might wait hours for the cars to pass. And then, as the echo fades, I'll bend down and count the strands of grass. But one thing that's bound to be is that instead of pulling at the earth, I'll just pet it as a friend. And when that train engine comes near, I'll nod my head to the big brass wheels and say howdy to the engineer and yell that Joni says hello. And watch the train man scratch his head and wonder what I meant by that. And I'll stand up and remember when rock was flung by a devil child. And I'll walk my road somewhere between the unseen green and the jet black train. And I'll sing my song like a rebel wild. For it's that I am, I can't deny. But at least I'll know not to hurt, not to push, not to ache, and God knows, not to try. Thank you. And, very much, I think Mark is going to play done by Seeing Bob Dylan. I believe. Great.